passage of scripture for a couple weeks, and I want to reference it here real quick before we jump into things. And this is Jesus talking. He said, if you abide in my words, you're my disciple, and you will know the truth, and the truth will do what? Set you free. And so that's a statement Jesus said, and the people listening, they answered, and they said, well, we're the descendants of Abraham. We've never been in any bondage. How would you make us free? It was a weird statement, because all through the Bible, the descendants of Abraham have been in and out of bondage. See, they didn't even realize that there were some areas of their life that they weren't really free in. But this scripture is specifically talking to us as believers. And it goes on, and Jesus ends up saying this. He said, whoever commits sin becomes a slave to sin. And a slave doesn't abide in the house forever. The Son abides in the house. So if the Son abides in your house, whom the Son sets free is actually free what? Indeed. So the Bible is very clear. We can be a believer and have some areas in our life that may be bound up and we're not as free in. And I believe this, God wants to free you in any area of your life that's restricting you or limiting you or restraining you. And sometimes all we need is just to get a little bit of revelation that there is something there holding us back. And then be obedient and watch God break us free in an area that maybe had us limited. And so the first experience this morning, we had so many people set free from an area I'm going to deal with this morning. Last week, we talked about how to get free in the area of worry. If you weren't here last week, I want to encourage you to go online and watch that. But I believe that God spoke to me in August of 2017 and said 18 is going to be a year for LifePoint Church to experience freedom. So that's why we said this is your year of freedom. And I believe God's just wanting to free some things so he can bring some more blessing your way, do some greater things in your life, and do some greater things through you. Amen? So let's put a hand to heaven. Let's say this. Say, I believe I'm in the right spot for God to do something great in me and for me and through me. Amen. 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 So I believe this morning God's going to move some more mountains in your life. Well, why don't you give somebody a fist bump? You can grab your seat, and I'm going to teach you up if you'll let me this morning. Right? So I'm going to teach you up, bring some revelation, bring some truth. Thank you. When you know the truth, it does what? Sets you free. And so I believe that sometimes we're like the people Jesus was talking to. We don't always know there's some things we need free in. But we're going to discover this morning. Y'all ready to go? So I need you today to open your heart. Don't think during the message for the next few moments of who needs to hear this. You know how we get sometimes? Well, boy, I wish such and such was here. They need to hear this. I just need you to open your heart and say, God, show me what may be pertaining to me this morning. And so let's start off this way with a scenario. As I mentioned last week, we talked about getting free from worry. We're going to talk about getting free today from a different area. So here's a scenario. You have a few minutes break at work, and you log on. Maybe it's a news website. Maybe it's Facebook. And you see something that jumps off the screen at you, and it comes with some very detailed graphics and some unsettling things you see on the screen, and let's say it is a dictator who sets off a chemical bomb and kills several civilians, mostly women and children. And as you watch it, the first thing you think about is how sad it is, and then something inside of you starts to get a little tense, and you get really, really upset and angry, if you will, over an injustice that you're watching happen. Let me give you another scenario. You are driving through a parking lot at the shopping center, and you've scoped out your parking spot. It's got God's favor written all over it. That's your spot. And as you're headed toward it, another vehicle comes and cuts you off and goes and takes your parking spot. And so you, because you love Jesus, you're just, God bless them. Bless them? No. Something else rises up inside of you, and you feel annoyed, and you want to ram your car into their car, or you want to pull up and hit the horn, or you want to jump out and lay hands on them in the name of Jesus, or you want to wave at them and tell them they're number one. Something just comes over you. Anyone ever been there? How about, let me give you another scenario. In January, the first of last year, 2017, I was teaching our team, and I just felt like I was supposed to teach a little bit on the fruit of the Spirit. You know, there's the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, patience, et cetera, et cetera. And so I was teaching on it, and when I got done, I said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to evaluate the fruit in our life. And I said, so this is not the time to be humble, but just pick, if you looked at your life, what fruit do you see just flourishing that the Holy Spirit is producing in your life? So we went around, everyone said, what's thriving? I said, okay, what's on the bottom of that list that may not be flourishing in your life? And so we all said ours, you know, out loud. And you understand, it's not something you can produce, it's the Holy Spirit that produces it. But we've got to surrender to the Holy Spirit, we've got to grow in the things of the Holy Spirit, and that fruit will grow in our lives. And it came around to my turn, and I knew what my weakest one was. It was patience. Anybody with me? It was patience. And so I went back to my office, and I sat down, and just for a few minutes, I thought I'd just look at this patience thing. Well, I come to find out patience wasn't exactly what I was thinking it was. Patience means to restrain anger. I thought, wow, so patience means if I have a lack of patience, that means I have some anger. And so I prayed this little prayer, and I said, God, I just want to surrender all the areas of my life, and I want patience to become a stronger area of fruit in my life. And I didn't know from that little prayer that over the last 12 to 14 months, God was going to be working something in me and working on something in me. And I realized something. It wasn't just a patience issue. I had an anger issue. And throughout last year, even into this year, there were times my wife would say, you just seem so angry anymore. Now, I haven't killed anyone or hurt anybody. I've wanted to, but I didn't. But I realized I just had this thing, and at times I would just set off and snap and just get angry. And I realized and she would say, why are you saying that? I'm like, I don't know. Be quiet. You're making me mad. And so there's these times I would just snap. Anyone feel my pain this morning? And so God just has been dealing with me about that. And so there are times that we all can get angry, but there are times I realize that anger can actually become an area we need free in. And so it's just like I said to you last week, I heard sermons growing up about worry, and they just said, don't worry. But no one told me how to break that power of worry. And I heard people say, we're not supposed to be angry. Well, no one ever taught me how to get free from that. So how about we do that this morning? So what I'm sharing with you today is sort of like a journey that God has brought me through to a place of getting some truth, to get some freedom in my life, and I believe it will work in your life. So that's why I said, don't think about who needs to hear this. Open your heart this morning. Anger, if I was to define anger, I would define it this way. It's a strong emotion of displeasure that's aroused by injury or insult. A strong emotion of displeasure that actually is aroused by an injustice or an injury. So everything I'm going to say for the next few moments is going to help you if you'll let it. And it won't just help you, I believe it will enlighten you. So anger, it's this emotion. It's really an instrumental motion, a second emotion, meaning there's something more behind it. And it's aroused when we see injustice or an injury. And so I believe there are two different types of anger. So I've got two lists for you. Let's look at the first list. The first list we'll put on the screen here. This is what I will call righteous anger. Everyone say righteous anger. So there's actually a thing that is righteous anger. And first of all, it's definitive anger. And what I mean by definitive is there's an injustice or there's an evil and it's recognized. And so it's very definitive that an injustice or an evil can make you angry. Now, if it's a righteous anger, it's today's anger. It's in the moment anger. It is something that is resolved. And I say it this way, it's manageable because it can come, but it goes. So what is righteous anger? It's definitive. It's an injustice. It's an evil. We can get resolve over it because we can manage it because it'll come and it'll go. It's today or in the moment anger. Now there's another list that I call unrighteous anger. So let's look at unrighteous anger. It is, instead of being definitive, it is distorted. In other words, we perceive an injustice toward us, whether it's fact or fiction. We perceive it to be an injustice toward us, so it's not definitive. It actually gets distorted. Now, it's different than righteous anger because righteous anger is today's anger. Unrighteous anger is yesterday's anger. There can be anger today and in the moment, but when anger begins to hang on from yesterday, it's unrighteous anger. It is unresolved, and instead of being manageable, it's toxic because instead of coming and going, guess what? It stays. So there are two different types of anger. There is a righteous anger, and there is an unrighteous anger. So look at the book of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26 and verse 27. The Bible actually has a lot to say about this topic of anger. It says, when angry. So the Bible is talking to us. It says, when angry. So it gives us the idea, guess what? We're angry. So when you're angry, do not what? Sin. And do not let your wrath or your exasperation or your fury or your indignation last until the sun goes down. And look at verse 27. Leave no such room or foothold for the devil, or give no opportunity to him. Now, how many of you ever heard someone say, don't open the door of the devil, don't give the devil a foothold? In context, it's talking about, guess what? Unrighteous anger. It's talking about anger. So there are two different types of anger. But the Bible says, in that anger, don't sin. Do not let the sun go down on that anger. In other words, deal with it, resolve it. And it says, if we can't do that, we're going to give the devil an opportunity in our life. So as usual, I've got a few life points for you this morning. Y'all ready to get some help in this area? Yeah. Life point number one, this is how I worded it. Anger is inevitable and it's normal in nature. Anger is inevitable and it's normal in nature. In its nature, it's a normal thing. It's an inevitable thing. Let me prove that to you. In the Old Testament, there are 375 times that it refers to God as being angered at evil or at injustice. So almost 400 times in the Old Testament, the Bible actually describes God as being angry toward evil or toward injustice. You say, well, that's the Old Testament. Okay, well, how about the New Testament? Probably the most famous or recognizable story in the New Testament is Jesus went to the temple. And when he got to the temple, they were having a flea market. And Jesus, the Bible said, got what? Angry. And he made a whip and he drove out all the merchants. He kicked over the tables and he said, my Father's house is a house of what? Prayer, a place of worship. It's not a flea market. And so we see that Jesus was angry. So the Old Testament, God was angry. In the New Testament, we see Jesus was angry at evil and injustice. Now, isn't it true that in the book of Genesis, it says we are the imago Dei, or we're made in the image of God? So if we're made in the image of God, guess what? There are times we're going to experience the same passions and even anger that God does, or that Jesus did. Being mad at an injustice or being mad at an evil. Matter of fact, I would say this to you, it should be normal that evil or injustice angers us. Actually, if it doesn't anger us, I'd say there's a bigger problem. So think about this. Our passions God put in us, even God was angered with those passions. Even Jesus was angered. So it is normal and it's inevitable. It's inevitable that guess what? In our nature, there's anger. And there should be injustices and there should be evil that makes us angry at those things. Anyone feel a little bit better now? No? Okay. Anyone feel a little bit better that it can be inevitable, it can be normal? Well, let me go on and build on this. You won't feel so good in a moment. So it's inevitable, it's normal to feel some anger. Here's the second thing I want you to know. The anger becomes dangerous if it's not dealt with properly. So it may be normal, maybe inevitable, but if we don't deal with it properly, it becomes dangerous because it has a destructive nature to it, or it has a destructive force to it. Actually, anger will destroy three areas of your life. The first area of your life it destroys is intimacy. It will begin to destroy your ability to connect, your ability to be intimate with family, with friends, with spouse. It'll affect the intimate part of your life. And here's why. The opposite of anger is love. And anger separates and divides. Love unites. Even in marriage, think about this. There's two people who fall in love, and they're in love, but yet you go down the road and you fast forward in their life and they get to the crossroads of divorce. What happened? Well, there was something that brought division. Usually there's a sense of spirit of anger there somewhere. And the Bible even says this in the third chapter of Colossians. It's talking to husbands. It says, husbands, love your wives and do not dwell with them in bitterness or anger. So the Bible speaks about in relationships, we need intimate relationships. Whether it's marriage, friendship, whatever it might be. But if anger, let me say this, we all face anger, but anger can become a stronghold in your life. And you'll notice that it will start to erode your ability for intimacy. Second area that it starts to destroy in your life is optimism. See, what happens is anger starts to distort your expectations. It distorts your outlook. It distorts your perception of things. I said this last week that worry always robs your peace. And if that's true, then your joy is stolen by anger. So if worry robs your peace, anger steals your joy. And we know the Bible tells us the joy of the Lord is our strength. And so anger can begin to not only destroy our intimacy, it can also destroy our optimism. In other words, we start to expect bad things. We start to welcome bad things. Our perception is distorted, and we just, oh, well, that always happens to me, or why does this happen to me? And so our optimism is distorted. Ralph Waldo Emerson said this. He said, for every second you're angry, or every minute you're angry, you've lost six, let me say this again. For every minute that you're angry, you've lost 60 seconds of happiness. For the time we spend being angry, we're losing our joy. We're losing our happiness. And so this is what anger does. It starts to erode at your intimacy. It starts to erode at your optimism. And then the third area it starts to destroy is your passion. God made us to be passionate people. And this is why the Bible said, do not give the devil a foothold or an opportunity in your life, because what it does is starts to distort or erode our passions. So the devil does a couple things. He deceives and he accuses. He will deceive you into believing, and he whispers in your ear, if you do the wrong thing, you'll get a right result. Or if you do the right thing, you'll get a wrong result. He tries to deceive you out of dealing with these areas of your life, or he accuses you. He keeps accusing that thing that someone did to you over and over again, and it plays like a movie. After the first experience, I had someone come up to me just talk about they can't break this memory thing they had of something that happened, and so it's triggering this anger in their life. So the devil's crazy. He accuses. The devil whispers these deceptions in our ear. But these are the three things that are the consequences of anger that's not dealt with. Our intimacy, our optimism, and our passions. Look at a few verses. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse number 9. Look what it says. Do not be quick in spirit to be angry or to get vexed. For anger and vexation lodge themselves in the bosom of a fool. So what the Bible was saying is anger and vexation wants to get into your heart. It wants to get into the core of your life. James chapter 1, verse 19 says this, understand this, beloved brethren. So he's talking to us. Let every man be very quick to hear. In other words, be a ready listener. Be very slow to speak. Be slow to take an offense, and be slow to get angry. For man's anger does not promote the righteousness of God that he wishes or he requires. So get rid of all the uncleanness. Get rid of that rampant outgrowth of wickedness, and keep a humble, gentle, and modest spirit. Look what it says. Receive and welcome the what? The word. What is the word? The word is the truth. The word is Jesus. If we will be slow to get angry and offended and keep welcoming the word, look what it says. It will be implanted in you. It will get rooted in your heart. And it contains the power to do what? Set your soul free. Set your mind free. Set your heart free. If we'll receive the word and we'll receive the truth, as we said earlier, the truth's going to do what? Set you free. But we've got to welcome the word and not let this anger go undealt with. So, these passions that God gives us, what anger does is it starts to counterfeit or it starts to replace the good passions in our life. Now, here's the deal about anger. Anger can, it implodes or it explodes. Matter of fact, depression is actually anger. But it's not exploding, it's imploded. So I want to just read to you a little list of the passions that will happen in your life because of anger instead of the passions God wants you to have for life, for your purpose, for the call of God, for the things of God. They'll get replaced with some things like this. How about this? Resentfulness. Being moody or irritable. Being depressed, I mentioned. Being strifeful. Being hateful. Being bitter. Being full of criticism. Being impatient. Frustrated. Even volatile. Becoming very judgmental, and even becoming vengeful. That's the passions that will overtake your life if anger takes a root. Instead of the passion, instead of the fruit God wants us to have, these things will start to take their place. Now, I know none of you guys, but those who are in the 930 experience, they needed this message. Now, there's a few little things I want to add to that list that are actually very eye-opening. And one would be this. If we don't deal with anger, let me tell you where it's going to show up. It's a word called iniquity. In other words, it means it's going to go into your kids. How you deal with these things is how your kids will learn to deal with these things. And if you know it's been a challenge in your life, then you know I don't want that to visit my children. But how we learn to deal with this anger thing is actually how they're going to learn to deal with it. So iniquity. Here's another probably stronger result. Is just fatigue. And here's why I say that. You only have so much capacity and you only have so much emotional energy that anger will put you into overdrive. You only have so much emotional energy or capacity and anger will put you into overdrive to where it will just wear you out. And if you know, if you've ever dealt with this, you just feel tired, you feel wore out. Here's another really strong result. And it's what I call infirmity. Now, I'm going to read to you a list of some things it actually does to you physically. Now, just because you might have one of these doesn't mean that it is because of anger, but it's a sign that it could be. Some things like this, high blood pressure as a result, abdominal pain, problems in your central nervous system, arthritis, immune deficiencies, back pain, those are all. Now, if you have that, doesn't mean, but it creates, in other words, it doesn't create just emotional result consequences. It actually produces physical consequences. So this anger thing is actually, it's normal and inevitable, but if it's not dealt with, it becomes destructive. And it will destroy your passions, it will destroy your optimism, it will destroy your intimacy. Now, a few years ago, this is before me and my wife moved back from Ohio, and I was actually traveling from Ohio to West Virginia to speak at this big youth rally, and my assistant was with me in my truck, and as we head down the road, all of a sudden my truck started to make a really weird noise, and a little red light come on. He looked at me and said, "What's that noise?" I said, "I don't know." He goes, "What's that red light?" I go, "Oh, it's probably nothing." So I thought, here's how you cure it. You turn up the radio, right? You don't hear the noise anymore. Well, about 40 miles further south, all of a sudden, I ended up on the side of the road because my truck quit. It blew the transmission up. And we were stuck in the middle of nowhere in Ohio. You know, the middle of nowhere where you have no phone reception? So we found ourselves hitchhiking on the freeway. We were miles from really anywhere that could help us. All because I didn't pay attention to the little warning light. Now, your car has these little warning lights. And it usually comes on a little ahead of time to start to give you warning that something isn't functioning right. And here's the deal. If you avoid it long enough, it will eventually cost you. The reason why that light comes on is to what? Warn you that there is a potential problem. Because it's the same way in our life with things like anger. There will be a warning light, and we can't ignore it forever. Because it will eventually what? Implode, or it will explode. So it is inevitable. And it's normal in its nature to have passions and to get angered over injustice. Or maybe someone hurt you or they abused you or an ex-spouse did something or a parent did something or a boss did something or there's a tremendous amount of hurt somewhere in your life. to be angered over that injustice is proper. But if we don't deal with it, it becomes a root of stronghold in our life that's destructive. And what someone did to you alters the rest of your future and your intimacy and your optimism and your passions. So what do we do about it? How about we find a cure? Y'all want a cure or you just want to be angry? Okay. Hey, no, tell me. Here we go. Colossians chapter 3, verse number 8. The Bible tells us some things to do with this. So Colossians chapter 3, verse 8. But now put away and rid yourself completely of all these things. Well, what things? It's going to list them. Things like anger, rage, bad feelings toward others, curses and slander and foul mouth abuse and shameful utterances that are coming from your lips. In other words, you're getting angry, you're getting rageful, and the things that are going to come out of your mouth, the Bible says, put those things away from you and rid yourself of those things. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 31. So let all bitterness and all indignation and wrath, which is passion and rage and a bad temper, and resentment, which is anger and animosity, and quarreling, which is brawling and clamor and contention, and slander, which is evil speaking, abusive and blasphemous language, let it be banished from you. So the Bible says, put it away from you. Let it be banished from you with all of its malice, which is spite, ill will, baseness of any kind. And, so banish it and become useful and become helpful. Here's the deal. When our lives get full of anger, we're not real useful, and we're not real helpful because we've got an internal issue going on. So the Bible says, and become useful, be helpful, be kind to each other, be tenderhearted, have compassion, have understanding, have a loving heart, forgive one another readily and freely because God in Christ forgave you. In other words, if God forgave us of our debt, the Bible says, we've got to begin to learn to release and forgive people. Now, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. Check out this scripture. Y'all doing all right? Exercise foresight. Be on watch. Look after each other and see that no one falls and fails from grace, which is his favor and his blessing. In order that no root, everyone say root. We know fruit comes from the root, right? So there's no root of resentment, which is bitterness and hatred. Don't let it shoot forth. Don't let it cause you trouble and bitter torment, and the many become contaminated and defiled by it. The Bible says this. We need to take some foresight and make sure that there's no root taking place in our lives of resentment or bitterness, because it will cause us trouble, it will cause us torment, and it will contaminate, and it will defile. And it says right here, it will keep us from the grace of God. It will keep us from the favor of God. It will keep the blessings from God from flowing in our lives because of this issue that we're talking about today, which actually is this spirit of anger. So there are these two types of anger, but we've got to make sure we're dealing with it or it becomes destructive. So here's how we deal with anger. Are you ready? Anger, number three, is deleted by forgiveness. Anger is deleted by forgiveness. So let's camp here for a few moments. You've heard me say this. Let me put it in perspective for you. Anytime that you know that you're really dealing with a bondage or you're dealing with a stronghold means it's cyclic and I just can't break free from it. And if you know any area of your life that may have a stronghold to it, the formula is really simple. We recognize it, we repent of it, and we receive the grace and goodness of God. So let's put that into practice here with this issue of anger. So we have to recognize if there's an issue of anger in our lives. And as I mentioned, this message is coming from sort of a year I've spent trying to figure out how do I deal with this? Where did this come from? And they say that there are three places that anger comes from. The first place it comes from is from unmet expectations. You have expectations in relationship. You have expectations in life. You have expectations in certain things. And when they go unmet, it makes you angry. Have you ever had a certain expectation level when you went to a restaurant and they didn't meet those expectations? You know what I started to find out? Every restaurant I went to, they were failing my expectations. And it went from frustration So I almost got to the place where I felt it was my need to tell them. I remember being in a restaurant, and the waitress came, brought us our drinks. I didn't see her again. So I got mad. I went to the kitchen and got my own drink. How many have ever been there? How many have ever wanted to do that? How many have ever done that? You're a bunch of wimps. I did it. I walked in the back. People were looking at me. I got my drink. I went back, and the one guy's like, well, they haven't been to the table. I don't blame them. Blah, blah, blah. But I went back, got my wife's like, oh, are you kidding me? What are you doing? You guys are, my kids are like this. Now, it was a terrible waitress, but I was mad. Now, especially if any perfectionists in the house, man, if you're a perfectionist, you're going to be prone to this. But expectations. Now, the stronger and the more required those expectations are, the stronger this challenge is. So unmet expectations, which is disappointment. Another place it comes from is feeling threatened. When you feel threatened over something, and sometimes the threat is followed through, or it's just a threat, and once again, that level of threat could be a low level, could be something simple, or it could be intense. It could be abuse, could be anything, but you feel threatened. And let me say this, behind every issue is a spirit. And once again, fear is behind this thing of anger, because here's why. Fear is a prophetic spirit. Here's what I mean by that. Fear will prophesy to you. It will whisper in your ear. Well, they did this to you. Or this is going to happen to you. Or how dare they try this against you. Or how dare they make you look like that. How dare they don't do it. How dare. It's a prophetic voice. Fear is. How do you deal with a spirit? You deal with it with the opposite spirit. So what's the opposite of fear? It's faith. And faith is a prophetic voice. You've got to let the voice of God, the word of God, the promises of God, the scripture of God be the prophecy that comes out of your mouth. So anger comes. I've got unmet expectations. I feel threatened. Or a very strong one is called rejection. Rejection. Now, next week, I'm going to spend the whole morning talking about the power of rejection. So I'm just going to hit it for a moment here. But look at the power of rejection. And let me explain it to you. Rejection is when somebody hurts you or they injure you. And because of it, there's pain. And that pain becomes an offense. And the more you think on it, you step into resentment. Resentment is you could say resentment this way. It's called smoldering anger. Over and over it plays because of how you were treated, and it smolders. And resentment turns into bitterness, and bitterness is the root that we just read about. It becomes a root in your life, and it starts to produce fruit in your life. And a root starts from a seed, and the seed was what someone said to you, someone did to you, how they treated you, what was unfair, and all of a sudden now that seed grows, and that root is going to grow as strong. There's two things that strengthen it, the length of time and the nurture that is given. If you nurture that issue, nurture that problem, it becomes settled anger, and it gets firmly fixed in you. Now it is a stronghold, and you know it's a stronghold when you start to logically explain the grounds for your anger over and over and over. That's the seed, and it becomes a root, and the root eventually takes over. We have to recognize it, and what it does is it makes us a victim, and Jesus never, ever called us a victim. He was never a victim of the cross, but then we start operating as a victim, and anger begins to control our lives, but we've got to recognize it. Second thing we have to do is we've got to repent. This is where the forgiveness part comes in. And listen, I know everyone's heard a message on forgiveness. And I know, you know, as believers, God calls us or requires us to forgive. But if you just give me a couple minutes, I want to unpack the real picture of forgiveness. And I know, depending on how much rejection was there or how much pain was there, it makes forgiveness very challenging. This is why the disciples said, Jesus, you got to increase our faith if we're going to forgive people. And it is a faith issue because forgiveness is not feelings, it's actually faith. See, people lie to you. They say, you know, you just need to forgive and forget. That's not in the Bible. We forgive and forgive and forgive. We don't forgive and forget. There are going to be some things that our minds are like computers. We don't forget things. Now, God can ease the pain. I'm going to tell you how he does it here in a moment. But forgiveness is not a result of us forgetting something. It's us putting faith to something. Now, so I worked on this message the other day, and then I wrote some stuff down that I felt like God just gave me. Then I want to help you. If you're a note taker, you might want to write. I'm going to keep moving here. But the reason why we struggle to forgive is because there was an injustice that happened to us. And anger becomes the instrumental emotion from that. And anger really is the refusal to heal. At the root of anger is an unhealed pain. It's an unhealed hurt. So give me your heart for a moment. We want this anger deleted. We have to meet it with forgiveness. And the Bible said, you got to deal with this root and you got to forgive in Christ just like God forgives us. How many know we had a debt of sin that God forgave us of? And the Bible says, if we don't forgive as he forgave us, we will stop forgiveness flowing in our lives. Here's what unforgiveness does. It does a few terrible things in our life. And these, I don't have time to go over these scriptures, so just stick with me. First of all, it hinders our prayers. It will hinder our prayers. If you're questioning, why aren't my prayers working? We need to check if we have some anger going on, some unforgiveness in our life, because it'll hinder your prayers. How many want your prayers to be efficient? So if they're being hindered, we need to stop and say, is there unforgiveness in my life? Here's another thing that unforgiveness does. It gives the enemy an advantage in our life, an open door in our life. It's like opening the door and saying, Satan, come on in. Well, no one would do that. Would you let a thief into your house? Would you walk to the front door and open the door and just say, thieves, come on in? No, you would guard and you would protect. Unforgiveness leaves you unprotected. Unforgiveness creates torment. Actually, the word for torment when it talks about unforgiveness is the same word that describes people who are lost in eternity in hell and the torment they're in. It's the same word for torment. And it will torment you emotionally. It will torment you mentally. It will torment you spiritually. It will torment you in your feelings. It's a spirit of torment. Bitterness is another result of unforgiveness. It's that root we talked about. And attacks on your health. That's what unforgiveness does. Now, I'm not just saying because you have a certain health issue, it's unforgiveness. It could be. And we're going to deal with this unforgiveness thing in a moment, and you could be healed right here today by releasing something. So this unforgiveness really means to let it go. But how many of you have ever let it go? It seems like it comes back. Now, let me help you. Y'all want some help? So I wrote some things down. Forgiveness doesn't mean that you're excusing the other people's actions. For me to really forgive that parent, that family member, it doesn't mean that I'm excusing or pardoning their behavior. Because a lot of times, we struggle with forgiveness because we feel like if we forgive, it's like saying, it's okay what they did to me. It wasn't okay what they did to you. It wasn't okay that they hurt you. It wasn't okay that they abused you. It wasn't okay that they rejected you. It wasn't okay that they lied to you. It wasn't okay that they said it. It wasn't okay. But forgiveness doesn't say it has to be okay. Forgiveness doesn't mean that you shouldn't have any more feelings about the situation. Because it was injustice to you, doesn't mean the feeling of what happened has to go away. It just means you can't live by the feeling. Because if you're living by the feeling, you're giving the keys and the power to the person who hurt you to continue to hurt you. And there's no freedom in that. How about this one? Forgiveness doesn't mean you should forget it ever happened. Doesn't mean you have to forget that it ever happened. Because a lot of times what happens is we hear a message or the Bible teaches us to forgive, and we still have a memory, and we feel like, well, I haven't forgiven. Well, you can forgive and there still be a memory. Now, those things will fade after time. And if the person is not in your life anymore, it's easier that it goes away. But if the person is still there, there's a memory, it's connected to them. So you got to continue to know that this doesn't mean, am I helping somebody? How about this one? Forgiveness isn't just an eraser that wipes all the pain away that happened to you, because the pain was real. How about this one? Forgiveness isn't what you do for the other person. It's actually what you do for you. If someone did something to you and you won't forgive, it's like you drink the poison and think it's going to destroy them. Actually, forgiveness is an area of your life that it's okay to be selfish in, because really forgiveness is about what it's doing to me. You can't change what they did to you, but you can change how you go forward. And forgiveness takes the power away from the person who hurt you. I wrote this down, I'll put it this way. You're not responsible for the destruction that was caused, but you are responsible for the cleanup to make sure peace is restored in your life, to make sure joy is restored in your life. So really, what is forgiveness? It's not getting someone off the hook. It's not denying their injustice. It's saying, you know what? You may have said or done this, but I'm taking away the power over my life anymore by releasing and letting it go. It's what forgiveness, it's just letting it go. Colossians chapter 3. Therefore, as the elect of God, that's us, holy, beloved, put on the mercies of God, put on kindness, put on humility, put on meekness, put on long suffering, bear with one another and forgive one another. If someone has a complaint against another, forgive as Christ forgave you. You must forgive that way, the Bible says. It's a choice. It's not a feeling. So we recognize that we repent and we receive God's grace and the help of the Holy Spirit. Man, am I reading someone's mail this morning? Someone walked up to me this morning after the first experience and they said, you must have been in our conversation last night at home. I said, I'm just preaching what you said. No, you don't know what you preached this morning. God wants you free from a spirit of anger. God wants you free from a spirit of resentment, from a spirit of bitterness. He wants your prayers answered. He wants your body whole. He wants you to shut the door where the devil got an advantage in your life.